What's up, YouTubes? Okay, this is a video I've been wanting to make for a long time. We're going to answer today why, after millennia, we switched from one rudder to two rudders on sailboats. I'm not going to explain which one's better, which one's safer, which one's easier to handle. That's all been covered before. We're going to answer the most important question, why? Because if you don't understand that, then you don't understand your boat. You need to understand what was the catalyst that made one rudder not work anymore. Why is there two? And that will answer, is it safer? Is it easier to handle? What are the implications? What do you need to do with your sails? What if you push it harder? What if you add bigger sails? What is all that going to do to your boat? That is the most important thing for me to put across to you. So this video is going to be kind of a nerdy technical video, but if you have a boat with two rudders, if you're thinking about buying one with two rudders, you need to understand this. I'm going to try to stay as objective as possible during this and just use factual information, but if you'd like my opinion, I'm going to give it in the last chapter, right at the end of the video. So if you're just here for that, go to the last chapter. If you want to understand this topic, please join me. Let's go. Okay, so the question is, why are two rudders better than one? Why did naval architects decide to use two? And in order to answer this question, you have to have a basic understanding of how a rudder works underwater. So let me explain. Okay, think of a sailboat as having a whole bunch of wings. So the foresail is a wing, the mainsail is a wing, the keel is a wing, and the rudder is a wing. Have you ever taken your hand and put it outside of your car window when you're on the freeway? And as you tilt your hand up, it pushes your hand up, and as you tilt your hand down, it pushes your hand down. That's the exact same effect, except your hand is straight up and down, and now you're in something that's 830 times more dense than that air, water. When you turn the wheel on a sailboat, it pushes that rudder one way or the other, and now the force of the water on this side pushes the forward end of the boat the way you want to go. That's how a sailboat steers itself. I've mentioned this many times before, but the consumer market of sailboats is always heavily influenced by the racing market of sailboats. And over the last 20 years, the racing technology has lent itself to wider and wider sterns, which for the consumer market had the added benefit of these huge cockpits and these huge aft cabins, which were big selling points. They're huge. They're so huge that Oyster and Halberg Rossi and Amel and all these sailboat companies that were once just focused on being the best offshore yacht have now had to change their designs because they're losing so much market share. And these wide designs not only provide bigger living space, but they provide a way better sailing experience when going downwind. They'll surf like crazy. But they also dramatically change the characteristics of the boat when it's heeled. And that's what we need to talk about. As this type of boat heels, the windward side of the hull comes out of the water, sometimes even enough to lift a centrally mounted rudder out of the water as well. The rudder will actually catch this air and all these bubbles will start cavitating around it. And that's what rudder aeration is. And it's a lot like this theory of the Bermuda Triangle. I don't know if you've heard it or not, but it's kind of cool, where they were theorizing that there was these big methane pockets that were frozen. And as they thawed out, they would just kind of explode and then aerate the water. That's why these boats were just disappearing, because boats and planes, as this bubble, big, huge bubble of methane came up, it would come up and spread apart and then come up underneath a boat and then just make the water, you know, half as dense as it was. And the boat would just whoop, and then it would go up in the atmosphere and do the same thing to planes. So planes would go down and boats would go down just in a second and just disappear, will seem to disappear. This is the same kind of thing. If you aerate the water, you make it less dense, it has less grip on the water, and now the boat end gets really squirrely. So because of those wider sterns, they had to choose a different way to control the boat. They chose to do this in a brilliant way. Instead of having one rudder that's centrally mounted on the hull that could aerate and ventilate and have problems, they just decided, let's just make two. We'll camp them out. And then when the boat is heeled, we'll have one central rudder straight up and down that'll never lose grip. And as long as you have both of those rudders, you're going to be fine. And even at extreme heeling angles, a wide stern boat with two rudders is always better than a wide stern boat with one. Okay, and that's fine and great. The two rudder thing, you solved it. You did a great job. But there's a bigger problem. And this is what most sailors overlook. As you widen the aft end of a boat, you change the buoyancy of the boat. And when the boat heels over, it's got more buoyancy in the aft part of the boat. When the buoyancy changes, becomes far greater on the aft end of the boat than the forward end of the boat, you change the center of lateral resistance aft and leeward. At the same time, it causes the CE, or the center of effort, that is the aerodynamic center of effort of the sails pushing on the boat, to move aft. And as that CE moves aft of the CLR, it causes weather helm. Weather helm pushes the bow aggressively towards the wind. The more the boat heels, the more weather helm you get, the more it fights. So if you take the aerodynamic center of where the sails are balanced on your boat, where that center of effort is pushing, and that lines up at the same spot as the center of lateral resistance, then you have a boat that's perfectly balanced. That means that if you set your sails to the wind speed, you can literally lock the wheel in the center and go make a sandwich and come back, and the boat should still theoretically be on the same course. That's not really what designers want. You always kind of want a little bit of weather helm. That means you want the front of the boat to try to go upwind when it can, because that's safer. You don't want the boat to fall offwind, because then it could jibe and then you could break things. So sailboat designers, architects, always put just a little bit of weather helm. So that's kind of what you're fighting as an offshore sailor. If you want to trim the sails perfectly, you're fighting that center of effort to center of lateral resistance. That's my problem with dual rudder boats. It's not the rudders, it's the wide transom. Because as they heel over more, hint, they heel over more when it gets more windy, it changes that center of lateral resistance. And it's constantly moving, it's constantly dynamic. Because they're so asymmetrical, there is no way to tell how far it's gonna go. So that means that you're never really balanced correctly when you're offshore. You can't just leave the boat for 3 days, because as the wind changes and as the boat changes heel angle, it changes that center of effort. And now the rudder's working harder, your batteries are draining faster, you're having to adjust the sails more often. It just makes it for a more difficult passage. And it's not just me saying this. Naval architects openly acknowledge this problem. For instance, this is Matteo Polli. He's one of the architects behind the Italia yachts. He says, "I think the double rudder blade solution is very effective only when the hull waterline is wide at the stern when seeking planing ability. I do not think this solution can offer the best compromise in the overall set of possible sailing conditions, despite it remaining probably the best for downwind sailing in a strong wind." This is exactly what I've been trying to tell you guys for years. In certain sailing conditions, two rudder boats and wide stern boats are phenomenal. If you're going downwind with the trades all the time, they're great. But as soon as you turn around and you try to go upwind, you try to go back to that island that you loved so much, it's just not the optimal solution. And this is why. It's because of that center of effort and CLE trying to fight each other all the time. So here's my personal take, as promised at the beginning of the video. As an offshore sailor, dual rudders are not an upgrade. They're a band-aid solution for a problem that's inherited by the racing community with these big wide transom boats. And as an offshore sailor, what is important to me with a boat's design is predictability, reliability, and simplicity. And if every time I trim the sails and the wind changes by 5 knots and the boat gets squirrely and gets a ton of weather helm and it's working the autopilot too much, and that's happening constantly while I'm out to sea, I'd rather choose a boat that was designed to have those two things work together. And that is the older designs. I'm sorry, but it's just physics. You're not going to get away from that. You're not going to convince me otherwise. I've delivered way too many boats. I know dual rudders in their envelope far superior. That hull shape is faster downwind. It doesn't heel as much. Yes, all those things. But actually offshore, actually sailing around the world, unless you're going with the trades the entire way around the world on the milk run, it's not a better choice, in my opinion. That's why I don't like it. I hope this helped you to make your decision or to at least understand the dynamic between the two. I don't mean to bash any certain boat or bash anybody that has a boat with two rudders. I just want you to understand the dynamic. The thing is, a lot of manufacturers are switching. And because they're switching, everybody's saying, well, you know, this is the newer technology. They're switching because this is what's coming. We just have to, don't be a Luddite, James. But when you stand back and look at the physics of it, you can see that they're switching because most of the people that are buying boats are not sailing offshore. These are boats that are more comfortable. They're very easy boats to own. As an offshore sailor, they are not better boats. I'm sorry, you're never going to convince me that they are. But as an inshore sailor and as a coastal cruiser, yeah, they work for a lot of people. All right, that's my point. I hope this helped. I hope you learned something from this. I don't want to badmouth your boats. If you have a dual rudder boat, I don't feel bad about it. Just understand that that does change. So you're going to have to pay attention more. And if your plans include going to Patagonia and going to Antarctica, maybe that is not the right choice of having these fat boats that have the changing buoyancy and changing CLR. I would love you guys' thoughts on this. Please prove me wrong. If you guys have sailed offshore and you've sailed some dual rudder boats and you have differing opinions, please comment below. Next week, we're going to talk about masthead rigs versus fractional rigs, because this is another thing I feel very, very strongly about. And until then, fair winds following seas, and I'll see you next week.